Okay, so this particular video I might call something like Wonderland and Spiderwebs. It's an expansion in many respects of the previous video that I presented. And again, that was very first person and questionable, no doubt. The particular information that I presented was the experience of me from a first person perspective and how I interpreted and adopted the data. Doesn't mean it's right by any means, but we're going to look at some sort of more unbiased empirical data to some degree. There's going to be some interpretation, of course, in this, just to kind of flesh it out. But generally speaking, I'll try to negotiate or detail when I'm talking more from interpretive land, a hermeneutic land, a sort of second person land, and when I'm kind of trying to present data more third person and objective in orientation. So to start with, we're going to look at the Q phenomena, which of course has played a very big scope in the alternative research community. It's really started to hit mainstream, this information. Then we're going to kind of move into, again, sort of a more hermeneutic lens, which is the spiral dynamics, fractal dynamics lens, into things like Terence McKenna and his time wave theory through the Mayan context, then into Petrus Romanus, which is the Pope, the notion of the last Pope in relation to Dr. Corsi and biblical prophecy to some degree, as well as 666 Fifth Avenue and how that might connect. So there's lots of data we're going to cover, and some of it I owe to many other researchers. This isn't my own work. I'm going to integrate it, I think, in some ways that haven't been integrated, hopefully. So let's start with sort of the thesis. Many of the big points, particularly that the Q kind of phenomena has, attached themselves to, I think, empirically a lot of it is true, but we got to be, careful about the final interpretation and what that means. Okay, so this is kind of a conclusion, how things unfolded. So we get the Fed, which cross-correlates potentially with the Titanic. Now that seems speculative, and you have to do your own research on the Titanic and why it sunk. But the Q theorists kind of suggest that the Rothschilds played a big role in sinking the Titanic, killing off many of the financial elites that were opposed to, in particularly, the adoption of a central banking structure. There's many important attitudes. We'll get into that too, to some degree, the financial construct and what that means in 2012 and the adoption of potentially a new world currency. But it's important to think about that 1913 was the creation of the central bank in the Americas, and now in almost every other country, with the exception of places like Syria and North Korea, think about that. Syria and North Korea don't have central banks, and look at what's happening to them. They are, North Korea is a scary country, but just think about that for a bit. But Rothschild thereby gradually starts to make money worthless in the Americas and really the world and its integrated system globally, the world financial construct. Then we get the crash of 29, which was in many respects quite massive, which led eventually into World War II, and tons of new government was then created. And it doesn't fix the problem that the Rothschilds created. The war kind of helped, but in the creation of the war, this thereby led to the CIA in many respects, and the CIA being puppeted, if this is true in many respects, by the Rothschilds. Okay, so we got the CIA being puppeted by the Rothschilds, and then they start to blackmail everybody with sex tapes of, scandalous, information, which is now potentially kind of coming out with things like Pizzagate, again, heavy stuff, just suggesting that if this is true, that's where that would go. We get, the sex tapes which lead to that. And then, and I'm not casting accusations, I'm just presenting what the Q, data is presenting, which then kind of leads to the media-consumed CIA, right? So the media is consumed by the CIA, which controls the people through the sex tapes, So you got to think about this as a hierarchical top-down construct in some sense, where very few people in the higher levels, can kind of control media in a kind of I can't say consolidated is kind of right, but it's more constricted aspect where a few people send top-down information to the next layer, which send top-down information to the next layer. The message is controlled thereby through the top in some sense, if this is right. Then by doing that through the media, the people watching the news, which in the 50s, 60s, and 70s were pretty much everybody, they get forced hard left. And that kind of any extreme, I think there's truths in the left and the right in general, but when you get forced hard left, you start to become an extremist in many respects. Now, most people wouldn't say I'm an extremist, but that's in many respects what would be happening if this is true. The media message would push you hard left and thereby become kind of an extremist, the average population. That makes the population puppets in many respects because the message is so far forced from what, is kind of really true, or what's really going on. This, however, causes the reaction if Q is right, if the Q phenomenon is right, or just generally speaking, alternative researchers to get patriots to kind of stand up against this. And we see this in the early beginnings, potentially, in people like Kennedy, who was, speaking out about the military-industrial complex and the kind of conspiracies in many respects that were ongoing there. He gets shot. Now, Reagan's a little bit more questionable. He got shot, didn't die. His message was to some degree that way, but it wasn't that strong. And then even more questionable when we get to Trump, but I still have hopes out that he is who he says he is. But we got to be a little bit skeptical as we dig in this a little deeper. And while they managed to kill Kennedy and outlast Reagan, enough lessons were learned that they now finally were ready to clear house. So the Q message is saying that that's what they're doing now, they're clearing house. Okay, so let's dig into, and this will seem tangential, but I think it will make sense down the road. Hopefully, this is my own research, and I've been functionally fitting it, hopefully, into the broader message. So I've talked about spiral dynamics before. It's a theory of biopsychosocial conditions. So each of these different conditions cause change. They cause thinking, social change, behavioral change in an individual due to the response of different life conditions. I'll just name out the nine levels that are kind of mapped out, 8 to 9 levels in the theory. So the first level we have survival, get food, drink, shelter for protection, procreation of species. It's kind of precognitive, it's kind of an animal world. This is early humans, 100,000 years ago. This is when we're seeing the quest for fire and these sorts of things. The second level, this is a different value shift. It's responding to the conditions of the previous life conditions. So then we get life, or tribe, family, rituals, placating spirits. This is purple, threatening, unsafe, mysterious world. So this is kind of magical. I put on a bear face. I dance around. I think I've adopted the spirit of the bear. Again, sort of precognitive in many respects. Now, with the third system, this gets into the tribal cultures, Mayan, Aztec, to a degree, Egyptian. We'll get into that a bit more because it plays an important role in the context of all of what we're talking about. So this is be the strongest or ally with the strongest to dominate. Life, therefore, is a jungle where the strongest thrive. So this is very much power-oriented. I'm the king of the castle. You're the dirty rascal. And ritual sacrifice. If you look in the Mayan culture, they would kill people to placate the gods or themselves in many respects. Maybe starting 10 to 15,000 years ago through the present, if our history is right, we got to question to some degree our historical annotations if it's actually fairly accurate. The next system that emerges is blue. So this is a response to red, so we create rules and regulatory bodies. In that sense, procedures, rules, the right way of doing things. Punish transgressors. So that red systems transgressors, we publish them and we create a orderly world or try to for life after. This is very godly oriented. This is heavenly oriented. If I act now or if I how can I say it? If I sacrifice now for something later, an afterlife and so forth. So in this sense, they see life as chaos without consistency and order, so we must build that order. The next system is a response to that. We see this in the 17th century coming mainstream. We see it a little bit in hints as ba far back potentially as the Greeks. And this is to say that, orange is kind of the strive drive. The fifth system is about rationality. So we're going to be creative, work hard, compete, get bigger, better, and more, improve, and win. Winning is important here. And in that sense, life is full of opportunity and rewards, the creative and the talented. Okay, if that's true, then we must compete to win and achieve through reason in many respects. So that was a response to blues' seemingly mythic tradition that doesn't question, it doesn't reason in that sense. And then green is a response to orange, which is reason. And they say reason's too hard and we need something softer in many respects. So we create equal opportunities, we serve fellow men, we build consensus, political correctness, and egalitarianism, relativism. This is to say that reason fails because each rational observer is fallible in their perceptions. Therefore, we must, kind of find a relational reason that connects, that's bigger than the sort of empirical observer that's isolated. And this is kind of multiculturalism and multi